Hello, dames and bombshells and bootleggers and all the ships at sea, and welcome to A Very Good Year, the movie podcast where we invite a guest to pick their favorite year of movies and talk to us all about that year. I'm your host, Jason Bailey, and across the mic and across the country from me is my co-host,
Michael Hull.
Our guest today, this is very exciting. Our first novelist, an Edgar Award-winning and New York Times best-selling crime novelist, whose books include The Turnout, Give Me Your Hand, You Will Know Me, Bury Me Deep, The Fever, and Dare Me, the latter of which was adapted into a television series for USA, on which she was a co-showrunner. She was also a staff writer on HBO's The Deuce, which is one of both Mike and my favorite television programs.
Cue the applause sound.
Yeah. And she also wrote the nonfiction study, The Street Was Mine, White Masculinity in Hard-Boiled Fiction and Film Noir, which I bet more than a few of you would like to check out. Her new novel is called Beware the Woman, and it is on shelves May 30th. Folks, say hello to the one, the only, Megan Abbott. Hi, Megan.
Hi. Oh, I'm so happy to be here. This
Thank
is exciting.
You. Thank you so much for doing this. So let's get the business out of the way first, because we like to give guests who are promoting something the opportunity to do that right off the bat. So tell us all about the new novel, which is called Beware the Woman.
Well, let's see. It's I will admit all my books are very movie inspired. So this one is a little bit inspired by movies like Rosemary's Baby. It is about a pregnant woman who goes with her husband to visit his father in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan, which is a very beautiful, very remote place. And while she's up there, she begins to learn things about her husband and his family that she did not anticipate. Things quickly go awry. So,
yes.
as they tend to do in these stories. So that's the basic idea.
We do love when things go awry. Yeah.
Yes.
So, okay, well, so you're this fabulous novelist. People know your books. They know your TV work. Anyone who follows you on social media, anyone, you know, like me who goes to Egghead film events in New York, and anyone who keeps listening and hears the year in the films you pick knows you are a serious cinephile. When did that interest in movies and especially in classic movies begin for you?
Really, it really does speak to our year, because it really, I grew up in suburban Detroit, and my parents were both movie lovers. Mm. It was just a movie family, but there was this actual repertory movie theater in suburban Detroit in the 70s and 80s, a very famous one called the Punch and Judy. And they showed old movies and new or newish ones. I mean, I saw Harold Maud there for the first time. I saw, you know, which had been out about 10 years at that point, and Bugsy Malone and things like that. But also gangster movies, screwball comedies, really Marx Brothers, really, it was just a gem. And so it wasn't just that I was seeing these on TV, which in that era, you know, with 5-4 channels, maybe, there were old movies on TV, but I also got to see them on the big screen, which is really unique. And I think really that was what sort of really got me excited, and 1930s movies in particular, because they were so shimmering and beautiful and glamorous. So as a kid, that was just like candy.
Wow. Shout out to the Punch and Judy then for bringing another cinephile in, more than one, I'm sure. You mentioned this briefly, you know, right at the beginning of the conversation, but so how has that interest in classic cinema informed your fiction writing? Like, how does that play into when you're devising a story, when you're putting it down on the page?
It's always in there, even when I'm not aware of it. It's sort of, I mean, I originally started writing fiction because I wanted to write my way into film noir. So my early novels are all these historical noirs and, you know, trying to sort of write in a lonely place, you know, walk into those movies like that. And so it's always in there. But I see it in other ways now that I'm writing more contemporary novels, scenes that emerge and you don't realize that you've stolen from it until after the book comes out. As it just like the visuals are so striking,
right?
And you know, moments, certainly just movies like Goodfellas, it's just like there's bits from it scattered throughout my books, or right. or the grifters, you know. And I don't know if anyone will be able to tell but me, because I need to picture the scene in my head to write it, but it's always there.
nice. All right, well, you mentioned, you know, that the 30s was a particular interest to you, coming up as a classic film lover. What year did you pick to talk with us about on this episode, and why did you pick it?
I picked 1933, which for any real golden age Hollywood people, they'll kind of know what that year means the minute I say it, because it's the sort of the last year before the production code in Hollywood started to be very strictly enforced. So, you know, up until then, especially in the late 20s, early 30s, which is sort of known as the pre-code, I'm doing air quotes, though. You two can see me, pre-code era was just a time when things were very free in terms of the content of the movies, in terms of sexuality and morality mm-hmm. and, you know, drugs and things that I think most contemporary people wouldn't think were in 1930s movies. Right. I think that was all invented in 1987 or something. So it's sort of the last gasp of freedom. And I think I was especially interested in it because for women in particular, it's sort of the end of having a lot of story, you know, for a while, of having a lot of movies where women drive the story and get to lead the action and behave badly.
Yeah, be complicated, for goodness sake, which is like something that's kind of seriously, like contemporaneously in short order, you know.
Right.
That feeling you're talking about is very familiar to me. Just like that, when you first start to see these movies, it's like it is shocking to see like bad behavior like this in a quote unquote old movie. But it's thrilling, and there's you really went hard on the pre-codes in this list, and I very much appreciate that about it.
Anything that came out before, you know, and the whole story about Hayes and how he got his name on it is also we don't have time for that
right.
now, but like read the Wikipedia at least on that, because it's a story in itself. But like there were so technically like any movie that came out before 1934 is a pre-code movie, right? But there's a particular kind of movie that gets referred to as a pre-code movie because it specifically has strong women characters who are acting with sort of a wink and a nod, you know, in several instances. It has some of those elements. People who like kill or get killed without a very clear white hat or black hat on when it happens, you know, that kind of thing. Like,
and maybe don't pay for it at the end, maybe
Jason,
sometimes,
you know, right?
Yeah, I know, right?
And this is something that we've talked about with some of the code, you know, movies after, where it's like you're watching some of these movies where it's like the bad guy is so bad, you're like comforted by the fact that, you know, he's going to get his before the thing is done, you know.
Right.
But I think that what you mean when you say like you picked some pre-code movies are these movies that contain those elements that were specifically outlawed by the code. This is a great list. I'm so happy you're on our show. Thank you.
Yes.
For coming around.
Thank you. No, that these are all ones that had problems, especially four in particular, one a little less so, but had real problems getting in before.
Yeah.
And a couple of them actually had problems in 1934 when they were going to be a re-release or something, because they were just unacceptable, even with the minor changes they maybe had to make before. Before in 34, Joseph Breen comes in. And, you know, everyone calls it the Hays Code because it is the Hays Code, but it was really Joseph Breen that enforced it.
Right.
And really... you know, really shut things down. And I will add, of course, there's great things about the code. I mean, you wouldn't have film noir without the code, because everything had to be hinted at and discreet, and it's so much more perverse, weirdly, in its morality. And you kind of often discount the ending because you know it's the cut, you know, but so the code did some interesting things. But I think, yeah, that when sound begins, especially into this year, because then you have the real American pattern of speech and urban, you have a real feeling of urbanity and urban spaces in these movies too. And there was something about the slanginess, the kind of coolness. There's just a kind of whole sort of American swagger. It's really American cinema kind of finding itself in certain ways that I think made seem more and more threatening than perhaps before.
Yeah, definitely. No, well, and it's this wild, this idea that, wait, so like after 34, they were trying to put these films back out and they were being so our society was going backwards at a certain point. We were changing our ideas of what was socially acceptable. I can't imagine such a thing.
Thankfully, that's the last time that ever happened.
Thank goodness. Those days are done. That's the past. All right. Let's take another look. Let's look a little deeper into the past. Mike's going to walk us through some 1933 headlines.
They're all crap, bro. I'm just going to tell you. I'm sorry. It's not my fault. On January 30th, German President Paul von Hindenburg appointed the dumb little mustache guy chancellor and started a whole thing that wouldn't end until Nazi number one shot himself in the face 12 years later, because they're cowards and losers. And eventually that's what they all do.
Yeah, well said.
There's lots of details of things, shitty things they did this year, but that we're going to move on. On February 10, the Postal Telegraph Company of New York City introduced the first singing telegram, which is a thing that you can still get.
Yep.
Costs about $100 these days, but you could probably get it down in this gig economy.
Here's the thing about the singing telegram. Whenever you say singing telegram, I just think of that one part in Clue. Like when I was 10 years old and the singing telegram girl appeared and got shot immediately, like that was the funniest thing I'd ever seen however old I was when Clue came out on VHS.
Have you been watching the news lately? Never mind. Don't get a singing telegram. They'll definitely get shot.
Yeah. Jesus.
President-elect finishes his impromptu talk and prepares to drive on to the railway station when... The startled onlookers suddenly realize what has happened. Pandemonium reigns, and the crowd, led by American legionnaires in their glistening helmets, pounce assassin Zangara.
On February 15th, Giuseppe Zangara tried to kill Franklin Roosevelt, but he was too short to see over the lady in front of him, so he had to stand on a folding chair, and that fucked up his aim. So he didn't actually hit Roosevelt, but he did hit five other people, and including he killed the mayor of Chicago. At his sentencing, he said, "I'm no afraid of that chair. You one of capitalists. You was crook men, too. Put me in electric chair. I no care." And they did just that, not even 5 weeks later. So
a slapstick tragedy.
So first of all, let me assert my firm belief that the only thing we have to fear is fear itself. Nameless, unreasoning, unjustified terror, which paralyzes needed efforts to convert retreat into advance.
On March 4th, Roosevelt was sworn in as president for the first time before Zangara was killed, but he apparently did not choose to pardon him.
Oh, well.
On March 5th, Roosevelt closed all the banks for a week because the Depression was cratering the world economy.
Sure.
And there were lots of other things that happened that year to try to combat the Depression.
Sure.
Famously, we didn't actually get out of the Depression until World War II because while there wasn't money for food, there was money for bullets. Oh,
yeah.
This is a movie show. I'm sorry, Jason. Also in March, Gareth Jones started reporting on the Holodomor, a famine in Ukraine that was created by Soviet leadership and killed millions and millions of Ukrainians.
Thankfully, again, that never happened again. Yeah, thank goodness.
Yeah, thankfully. We have a lot of problems, and I love nothing more than to point them out. But, like, at this point, Germans are passing national eugenics laws, and Stalin is committing genocide in Ukraine, and Mussolini is ruining Italy, and Franco is being a bitch in Spain. England and France are fighting to keep their colonies. Like, at the same time, Roosevelt is creating the Tennessee Valley Authority and, like, the Works Progress Administration, right?
Right.
And, like, Social Security and shit. Like, it's easy to look at the kind of patriotic movies that came out after this era, and they seem sort of, like, corny and silly, but like it really felt, I think, that in 33, legitimately, like we were doing something different, something good. Okay, I'm done. These 30s episodes get me so excited, Jason Bailey. I get very worked up.
I know.
One last Nazi story, and it's a good one.
Okay.
On April 20th, under pressure from propaganda minister Joseph Goebbels to make films that were more friendly to the Third Reich, Director and friend of the show Fritz Lang divorced his Nazi wife, Thea von Harbou, and on July 31st, he left Germany for good. Here's to Fritz Lang.
To come to Hollywood to make some of the best film noir.
Yes, yes, friend of the show. We love that guy. Yeah,
you know, we've all broken up, I think, with some people for silly reasons, but like wanting you to do more Nazi propaganda is a pretty good reason to break up with somebody. I'm going to put that in the thumbs up column for Fritz.
But 1933 was really defined on December 5th when the 21st Amendment to the U.S. Constitution was ratified, repealing prohibition, paving the way for wine snobs and home brewers and mixologists and also everyone who knows how to have a drink without making it their personality.
All right, good stuff.
So here's to that.
Yay for the end of prohibition. Yay for the end of bootlegging.
Poor people have sex. Yes. So some babies were born in 33. Susan Sontag, Ernest J. Gaines, Kim Novak.
Good.
Willie Nelson, Yoko Ono, Bob Rafelson, Nina Simone, the Queen, peace be upon her.
That's going to be my dream blunt rotation for this week, I think, is Yoko, Willie, Bob, and Nina Simone. I'll pass that.
Yeah, I think it could just be Willie.
That's probably... he could smoke Michael me Caine. Under the table, yeah.
Quincy Jones, who's still killing, like, who's still somehow killing life,
yep.
Amazingly. Ruth yep. Bader Ginsburg, Eunita Blackwell, Edward G. Robinson, Philip Roth, Renee Taylor, Jean-Paul Belmondo, Jean-Paul, let me put some respect on this man's name and pronounce it correctly, Jean-Paul Belmondo.
Okay.
James Brown, Jane Mansfield, Carol Burnett, Gene Wilder, Danny Aiello, neurologist Oliver Sacks, Dom yep. DeLuise was born in 33.
All right.
Had a great future ahead of him, Conway yep. Twitty, Fred Willard, anti-racist activist Jane Elliott, the lady who created the blue eye, brown eye exercise, and finally, Jason, tell me a joke.
Why is that, Mike?
You're so lame. Joan Rivers would have had me crying by now. Joan Rivers, born in 33.
Nice.
In sports, Primo Carnera beat Jack Sharkey in the sixth round to become heavyweight champion. England beat Australia 4-1 to regain the Ashes, employing bodyline tactics for the first time ever in a major competition. Big deal. I'm not going to mention the sport because you already said you won't talk to me about it
not.
In a different episode.
I will not.
Rolling to the starting mark, Speed King Campbell's 2,500 horsepower Bluebird is prepared for a record run at Daytona Beach. On the course, the tread tires are replaced with smooth ones to reduce friction, and the giant engine is primed. Are you ready, Sir Malcolm?
And finally, there was no World Cup, but Malcolm Campbell drove his car, the Bluebird, 272.46 miles per hour at Daytona Beach, Florida, setting the land speed record for the time. The Bluebird was a beautiful car. Look it up. He would be the first person to go over 300 miles an hour a couple of years later in a modified version of the car. And when I'm like tired and I can't like read anything important or want to work on important things anymore, he becomes my hero because he dedicated his life to something utterly fucking meaningless. So here's to Malcolm Campbell in 1933. That's headlines.
Thank you, Mike. All right, Megan, you ready to do a top five?
I'm ready.
All right, this is roughly ranked, as I understand it. These are variable. You won't gun to your head. You're not going to take these anywhere. But these are pretty roughly how you would rank your five favorites of 1933. So we are going to begin with a chiller from the director Michael Curtiz. Megan, what is the number five movie on your list?
This is Mysteries of the Wax Museum.
Exquisite. Almost as beautiful as the original. Someday I hope to have you restore Marie Antoinette.
What's the matter, sir?
Nothing at all, my boy. I should like to meet your friend.
Why, certainly, sir.
You will always be beautiful. Think, my child. In a thousand years, you will be as lovely as you are now. Come.
No.
Come.
Let me go.
Which I have to say is one of my more recent discoveries. I know I saw it as a kid, but there's a beautiful restoration yes. of it now. And I definitely didn't see this. I believe the Film Foundation and maybe UCLA were involved in it.
But, and the George Lucas Family Foundation.
Right,
yes. So like
that's
right. a little bit of love to George Lucas there.
It's good. I'll give it to him. This was a revelation seeing it again. I mean, it always scared me as a kid seeing it with alongside Universal horror movies and things like that. But is just a beautiful looking and terrifying movie that you kind of can't believe. It's, you know, it's 77 minutes, but so much story is packed into
it. Tight as a drum.
It's, yes, absolutely. Tight, like all of the movies we're talking about today. I mean, there's only one that's over 90 minutes or even over 80 minutes, maybe. it's Michael Curtiz, one of the great directors who never gets any credit because he worked in all genres and worked, you know, did the jobs he was assigned to very often, but it's, you know, it's Faye Ray, it's Glenda Farrell, who plays a reporter who's trying to sort of solve some mysterious missing bodies and potential murders, and she comes upon a wax museum and its sort of disfigured creator, and you can do the math, or if you've seen any of the other wax museum movies, I won't spoil it, but I think what it is for me is that it's so haunting in the way that early 30s horror can be. The visuals, you know, it's still the power of silent cinema, where visuals, they spent so much time on visuals, because a lot of early 30s movies, it does get pushed to the side because they're dealing with technical sound issues so much more. But here the images are just so beautiful, and it has this sort of unreal color, these sort of acid greens. It's the
two-strip.
The last of the two-strip movies. I think this and Dr. X, which I also watched. They are around the same time with the last ones. And so you have this sort of unreal quality to it that doesn't look colorized or old, or it just looks unreal, which when you're looking at these wax statues, just gives them this sort of power that is just magnificent. And it's also really gory and it has drug addiction and nudity. it's full pre-code, like chaos, you know. You can't kind of believe that they got away with it, but they did.
The two-strip, if for anyone who's listening who hasn't seen it and wants to kind of know what it is, if you've seen Scorsese's The Aviator, the sequences that take place sort of in the time frame around when they made this movie, he sort of digitally aped this two-strip Technicolor process. It has a very unique look, and you're right, it is sort of weirdly haunting and really effective in terms of the kind of waxiness that it gives everybody, which makes the whole movie a little more unsettling, I feel like.
Yes, absolutely. Because there's a lot of broad comedy and goofiness and shenanigans with the report, you know, but it all feels sort of, you have this anxiety around it that a lot of great horror movies do with the stuff before the stuff. Where you just feel this tension and everything's a little frenetic and strange, and there's the stillness of these wax figures and a kind of classic mad artist, mad creator, mad scientist personality, which it's become so iconic. Already was in literature at this point, but it's becoming iconic in film.
There's a beautiful and very recent Warner Brothers Warner Archive Blu-ray that preserves that from that recent restoration. But you're right, it's also like, I just watched it for this episode. I hadn't seen it before. I saw House of Wax years ago, and so I was expecting, you know, just like sort of an embryonic version of House of Wax. And this movie is as much His Girl Friday as it is House of Wax. Like, it's a really also wonderful, like, fast-talking newspaper picture, which, like, is one of my favorite kinds of classic films as well. So yeah, Mystery of the Wax Museum at number 5. All right. Megan, what is your number 4 movie for 1933?
Okay, so this is a huge one for me as a little girl. This is a bombshell.
Ever since I began to make a name for myself, he's been double-crossing me with his rotten publicity. He's nothing.
They seem to it that Lola Burns is a family slogan from Kokomo, Indiana to the Khyber Pass. Strong men, take one look at your picture, go home and kiss their wives for the first time in 10 years. You're international tonic. You're a boon to repopulation in a world thinned out by war and famine.
That's all very funny.
Directed by Victor Fleming and starring Jean Harlow, who I was obsessed with as a little girl. I thought she was the most beautiful and hilarious and fascinating creature in cinema. You sort of, the first original platinum blonde, the original bombshell, this really, her story, like many beautiful bombshells in Hollywood, is rather tragic. Yeah. She dies very young, a few years later. But this is really one of her first roles where she really gets to show how great she is at comedy. Yeah. And she was sort of wasted. And she's famously in Public Enemy, one of my favorite movies of all time, the great gangster movie. But she's terrible in it because she doesn't there. She's miscast, right. And she's and it's not well, you know, it's not really written for the but she plays the sort of mall in that. Right. But this is really when this year really and the year before there, when they, you know, Red Dust and is the year before this. In fact, there's some inside references to it in this, right. But she was finally coming into her own at the ripe old age of what, she's like 24, right. Or something when this is, but she'd been in many movies but it's about a movie star. So a movie star playing a movie star, and she wants to give up the game. She has all these sponges and her family are all hangers on, sort of, you know, everyone is trying to bleed her dry. And the studio publicist, played by Lee Tracy, in one of the great, my favorite performances of the 1930s. Yeah. The fastest talking. Yeah.
Slimiest.
We'll talk about his girl Friday. Yeah. But yeah, he's sleazy. He's, yeah. He's amoral and he's completely charming. And he's trying to get her back in the business and really will do anything to do so. And there's, you know, so she runs away. And I don't want to spoil. There's some great twist, yeah. Actually, for another very short movie, but it's really just one of the most delightful screwball comedies, one of the first great satires of Hollywood. Yes. There's so many inside jokes in this. It's sort of loosely inspired by both Clara Bow's life, because Jean Harlow has this private secretary played by the great Una Merkel, who is duplicitous, and that famously happened to Clara Bow, who I believe her secretary stole love letters, right. Of hers and sold them to the tabloids, but also sort of based loosely on Harlow herself, who had a sort of aggressive stage mother who married sort of a gangster who really, they were both bleeding her dry. And so there's some references to that in this as well. But mostly it's just this frothy delight. Yeah. And it's so smart. The script is just, you know, by John Lee Mann and Jules Furthman, who later write many great scripts. Yeah. But it's really, it's just sort of perfect. And Victor Fleming, like Curtiz, is another great journeyman director who just, you can plug him in and he's brilliant. Yeah. So it's, yeah, from childhood, this has always been the one. Also, the costumes are marvelous.
Yeah. Yeah. No. Yeah. Victor Fleming, you know, if the name sounds familiar to the casual movie lover, directed at least parts of both Gone with the Wind and The Wizard of Oz. Those were sort of famously team directed, both of them, but he got the on-screen credit on both of those, and was also briefly engaged to Clara Bow in the mid-1920s, I found out while researching the movie. So maybe a little bit of insider's knowledge there.
I would say so. And I think he definitely knew enough about the Hollywood game to really be making the most of this. And, you know, jokes at every turn. And
I'm sort of this is not the only one of the movies in your list here that sort of play on that, you know, Hollywood. I mean, I realize the movie we're going to be talking about next is more of a theater thing, but very similar in the way that they sort of deal with the industry from a performer's perspective.
The business of show.
From the business of show, right? And I'm curious, they're not sort of talking about these things as inside jokes. I'm sure there are some that are inside jokes, but there had to be a lot of assumed knowledge to think that these movies were going to play, you know. I mean, the next movie we're going to talk about, like, there's some big numbers in that. They spend some money on that.
Yeah.
So I'm sort of curious, like, how was it just people sort of reading tabloid magazines
or movie magazines? How was there this, like, yeah, the fan really magazines. Like, yeah. Oh, yeah.
People really had that level of information.
Yeah.
Well, and I think you have to remember that in the Depression, people, that was the only thing that they spent their money, little money they had on entertainment wise. So people were seeing like five movies a week. It's hard to imagine, right. Now, but everyone saw Red Dust with Jean Harlow. And there were, you know, as there were sort of movie magazines, we may think about now as more tabloidy, but there were also these sort of publicist pushed out glamour factory movie magazines that really were wildly popular, and every newsstand would be filled with 100. So not only had you seen every big movie, certainly every MGM movie, which is it, but you would have read all the magazines, and you would have consumed all of it. And that Jean Harlow at this time was, within 2 years, had become one of the biggest stars in the world. So I do think they knew. This was not, insider. I think there are some jokes in the next movie that are a little more insider, but I think this one is pretty straight down the middle.
Gotcha. All right. Well, Megan, what is that aforementioned next movie, your number three for 1933?
So this one was hard to pick. Actually, there are three amazing movies in 1933 with Busby Berkeley numbers, and I had to pick among the three, which is 42nd Street and Footlight Parade and this, which is Gold Diggers in 1933.
It's always the way. I got the show, I got the music, I got the cast, I got the theater all rearing to go, and it's the old story. Money.
I'm not kidding. I'll give him the money. He'll have it in his office at 10:30 tomorrow morning.
Where are you going to get $15,000?
We'll make those guys pay for their fun. Right through the checkbook.
Underneath your...
What do you know about me underneath?
I
know what you mean, yo sugar.
Which maybe has some of the most iconic of all
numbers.
Yes, exactly.
My wife was like, wait, is that what this is from? And then, of course, straight to the internet,
Yes. Well, because you see it so many times before you realize what it could be from. And I think if you know anything about movies, you probably heard the term Busby Berkeley, and you have a sense of these aerial shots. Right. But I think the extent of his visual style, he's not the director here. Right. I should add, this is also, Mervyn LeRoy is the director, but these iconic visual numbers, he who came out of the military and is amazing at putting large numbers of people in formation.
Wow.
Was also apparently a very dictatorial person, as you could imagine. But this was another one I loved as a kid, and I rediscovered as an adult for its subversive energy. So it's essentially a backstage musical, but it's very much about the Depression. I mean, it's the only one of the movies that we're talking about that actually explicitly mentions it, and really that was not that common. The idea was that people go
to escape
to the movies to forget it, right? Yeah, we don't want to think about it. But this is actually about the showgirls who can't afford to make rent and need to hustle, and a producer who wants to put on a show, and a lot of connivances, and
it's always the money. I got the script, I got the girls, I just don't got the money. I related to so many things in this movie. God, this movie was good. I loved it. This is a first time watch for me, and it was really fantastic.
Yeah, same.
And it was instantly recognizable as one of these sort of these Depression era movies where, they're sort of hustlers, like where you're sort of dealing with people who are hustling to stay alive. And like even though it wasn't really an explicit bit of conversation all the time, there's always somebody who's trying to get by. And I mean, in a lot of movies, there's somebody who's sort of scraping, right? And in this movie, it's very explicit about the showgirls are the smart ones, they're the crafty ones. And then literally some they literally Back Bay Boston Blue Bloods. They call them that. That's not my interpretation. Show up and they just start fucking running circles around these dudes from the minute they get there. And they show up saying, showgirls are crafty. I mean, they're gold diggers. That's the name, right? Like, you can't trust them. They come in the door waving, talking about, I see all your red flags and fall for every fucking trick in the book. It's just the way the movie sort of delights in that, working class hustle.
Absolutely, really, and celebrates
so much
really.
Fun. Oh my God, so much fun.
Yeah.
And these women are, you know, really would never be at the center in the same way. And there are a lot of stories about three women trying to find a husband. You know, that's a whole, you know, there's many to come movies like that. And that's sort of okay, even if they want a rich husband. But in this, you know, some of them may end up with husbands in this, but that's not really.
That's not driving the plot.
This is really, I think, the era when the American hustler is really defined in movies, but also explicitly that it can just as easily be a woman, and probably better, because they have, as we'll learn in our next movie, they have something that men don't have.
Yes, exactly.
And that, you know, there's so much sort of dirtiness in this movie that's delightful and winking. And you know, it's almost like the strategy to get around the code was to say it so fast that no one was really sure what they had said, because there's so much of that. But it has a really sort of openly filthy and very strange number called Patton in the Park, which is maybe about what you would think it's about, but it culminates
in later.
Some really strange stuff with the famous actor Billy Barty. Some of you may remember from later movies. I don't even want to spoil the visual sumptuousness and weird dirty jokes in that number, but they have an epic scale, those numbers. And every time I see one of Busby Berkeley's numbers, I think, there's no way you could do this on a stage. You know, it has to be a soundstage. Right. It has to be a movie.
Right.
It has this famous neon violins scene where apparently the women holding these neon violins for effect, God, they kept getting electrocuted. They kept getting shocked.
I assume they all got cancer, so that's probably actually better.
They just got like electroshock treatment that they didn't perhaps need. But the main number that I picked this for is one that I think is justly very famous, which is Remember My Forgotten Man, which is really, that's a phrase, Forgotten Man, that people have forgotten about now. But that really, it really was about the World War I vets who now were on bread lines and had fought, given everything in World War I. And now no one was caring about, this is directed straight at Hoover, outgoing, because they had marched on Washington under Hoover for not doing anything to help them get jobs. And this is a really Brechtian, it's even in the Brecht style of a musical number where it's speaking directly to this audience, and Joan Bondel giving this amazing performance, and this just gorgeous. Adam Mottens does this soloist of that. There's something sort of bluesy and haunting and subversive about the whole number. It's actually kind of a radical act. And it just, as seeing it as an adult, as a kid, I just thought it was, you know, visually so exciting. But as an adult, you see it and you see, wow, I can't believe this is in a major Hollywood movie.
Yeah.
Different times.
Yeah. You know what else I couldn't believe was in a major Hollywood movie was that back and forth towards the end with the every time you say cheap and vulgar, I'm going to kiss you. Woo! Good Lord.
Yes.
That is hotter than any scene I've seen in a movie in a few months. Speaking of hot, what is your number two movie for 1933?
This is maybe one of now the sort of most, when people talk about pre-code movies, because of it's subversive in a different way, but this is Babyface.
I'll need everything I've given you. All your bonds and securities.
I can't do it. I have to think of myself. I've gone through a lot to get those things. My life has been bitter and hard. I'm not like other women.
Get out of here or I'll...
Millie, you got to marry me. If you don't, I'll kill myself.
Directed by Alfred Green and starring the great Barbara Stanwyck, just also becoming a star in this movie. And she plays a young woman whose father runs this, essentially a bar, and is sort of tries to pimp out his daughter. You know, I'm not spoiling it because the movie itself is, 70 minutes? And this happens in the first three minutes. And
they take care of him real quick.
Yes, he's taken care of, and she moves to the big city with her friend, another unusual factor that you won't see once the code is in. But her friend is a black woman that she works with at the bar, who's throughout the movie her only confidant, and has a character unto herself. But she goes to New York, and she starts in the employment office at Gotham Trust, this large bank, and slowly works her way up through her wiles, which
literally sleeps her way to the top, like
you see her floor by floor.
I love this movie so much.
It's amazing. And she, you know, changes as she, you know, she's so, you know, she changes her look, her style, her technique becomes more sophisticated, but she just climbs her way up, and she is relentless in it, and it's so focused. Her ambition is immense, and it's just a star-making Stanwyck performance. And the whole premise of the movie will never happen within a year. Right. In fact, this is one of the ones that they couldn't re-release as it was, and that in fact had, there's a different ending.
Yeah,
that they
God, that
after. And now, yeah, God. It's a there's a,
it's I, a comically corrective ending.
Yes, I mean, it would be ludicrous. Yes. If like, she would literally change her personality in the last 3 seconds of the
right.
movie, which is what happens in a lot of postcode movies. But it's yeah, she's incredible in it, and it is in context unthinkable for this to be a Hollywood movie a year later. You will never see a woman get to seduce every man in the movie to rise and to feel remorse about things that happened to them.
Yeah, and with the sort of encouragement of a mentor and his Nietzschean philosophy.
He's like, with the iconic line, use men to get the things you want, and which Nietzsche didn't precisely say.
It's a rough paraphrase.
You're not quoting it there, but
it's a rough paraphrase. Yes.
Not a great time to quote Nietzsche, but we'll forget that. But it's she. There's some also. I didn't notice this, Jason, until I saw it this time. So I know you had seen it before. Had you seen it before?
No, this was the first time, and Jason was like, "This is my favorite pre-code movie. You have to watch it."
It was the first pre-code movie I ever saw. So like, that's really sets a high bar for like all of the other ones.
It does, and it's you know, I didn't, because you're so excited by her and the subversiveness of the story and it's sort of dirtiness, I didn't know there are some, it is very elegantly directed, and I don't, there's some amazing shots with what they convey visually about her personality, just that she doesn't feel any of the things that women are supposed to feel after 1933 in movies, and you just don't get away with that again. I kind of think everything Barbara Stanwyck does after word is shaped by this. She understands how to bring this into her performance, and this leads to Double Indemnity and, you know, and 100 other great movies. So yeah, this is special.
Yeah. So I've been combing Facebook, and I'm making a shot now. I'm doing an overhead shot of my record player, and I'm just gonna swipe in faces of people that I've slept with over the years, or maybe not. Maybe just people I wanted to slept with, or just maybe I'll just make up the faces so I don't have to like actually confront any of this. But yeah, I have to participate in this movie somehow.
Yeah. All right. Well, that is really, it's hard to imagine a better movie coming out in 1933. But there is one more on your list, Megan Abbott.
There is. This is the bona fide. I mean, I don't know. I think these are all classics, but this is the, I guess, the most canonical and probably the most perfect, which is Designed for Living.
Max, have you ever been in love?
This is no time to answer that.
Have you ever felt your brain catch fire and a curious, dreadful thing go right through your body, down, down to your very toes, and leave you with your ears ringing?
That's abnormal.
It's Ernst Lubitsch, one of the greats. Yep. Everything great in Hollywood, comedy-wise, perhaps comes from him. And certainly you wouldn't get Billy Wilder without Ernst Lubitsch. I mean, he's really... So this is written by Ben Hecht, one of the best screenwriters in the business, adapted from a Noel Coward play that apparently only uses one line from it, but it certainly uses the premise, which is essentially about a menage a trois with a woman and two men, which is also the most the most unusual yep. kind of menage a trois on cinema history for the next 50 years after it, which is Miriam Hopkins, one of the greats, Frederick March, Carrie Cooper, and she's a commercial artist. She can't decide between these two men she meets. One's a writer, one's a painter. So they decide to have what she calls a gentleman's agreement, where she'll move in with them only as a friend, and she'll be a mother to the arts and support them. And then things go sexual longings and erotic intensity and delicious froth and all the sort of beautiful gorgeousness of these three leads all comes to a head. And you kind of can't believe that you're seeing it again. It's got some of the best character actors in the business making it all spin. You know, you had Edward Horton, Franklin Pangborn.
Love him.
This is really, really one of the best. And every line is an innuendo. And Edward Lubitsch was sort of the master of suggestion. And the famous term is the Lubitsch touch, which is that there's, which is really, I mean, everyone would learn from him because they would need it the next year, because he really figured out how to like get multiple dirty meanings into everything, but make it seem so sophisticated. Yeah. And also that European sensibility, he is coming from Europe and has just a more sophistication about these matters, you know, a more cosmopolitan view of women, of sexuality, of the fluid nature of sexuality. Mm-hmm. So in some ways, you know, this could be a movie now in terms of that, because nothing in it stays in one place.
No, I mean, I think I've really seen an uptick over the past few years of young cinephiles discovering this movie and really attaching to it because that fluidity, because it's so ahead of its time and still feels fresh in terms of the sort of the sexual freedom of the thing. I saw it for the first time a couple of years ago, and the thing that was really astonishing to me about it was Gary Cooper. Just that if your image of Gary Cooper is High Noon, fucking watch Design for Living, because like you think of him as, you know, this sort of stoic aged Western hero, and he is so hot in this movie and sexy and interesting. It's a one, I mean, all three of them are great, but they're equally great. It's not like he gets smoked off the screen the way you think he might by Frederick March.
That's right. And then usually with a screwball romantic comedy, there's like the one she should be with and that kind of stuff, the one she's going to be with until, but they both, I mean, Frederick March, obviously very handsome, but he's so charming. And Gary Cooper is sort of less verbally charming, but he's so physically beautiful. Yes. he's almost more, well, he's in some ways more beautiful than beautiful Miriam Hopkins. And he's just so, and I think, you know, Lubitsch makes great use of that. And the way these actors are able to generate the heat in every scene it just makes it all sort of dance. And there are a lot of meta elements now that I think of it to all these movies, because the notice of the artist and what the artist conceals or reveals, or the sort of foolishness of the artist and the decadence of the artist, and how they want to be free, but then in the end, you know, they want to be the boyfriend. like all that sort of the way, I mean, it's a lot of these movies now. I think the last three are all about women manipulating male desire to a certain way, but also having it, especially in this one. I think this Miriam Hopkins' desire for both these men is palpable.
Yeah, no, that is one of the things I almost feel like the greatest endorsement you can give this movie is the fact that, yes, it was, you know, it made it through the Hayes office, but it was still banned by the Legion of Decency. And I think that is a huge feather in its cap. Yes.
In fact, it was refused re-release the following year. So they got all.
Got it out in the world. That's all that matters.
Let's bring back the era when writers and painters could be the leads in movies without living in their mom's basement. Let's get back to that. I was like, look at how like refreshingly like about art this is without being about art. You know what I mean? They're not worried about technique. They're just sort of the world they live in. Very nice.
Yes.
That's right. Exactly. That's right. And it can puncture its own self-seriousness too, which is always nice.
Ah, beautiful. An amazing top five list. Megan, thank you so much
for
bringing it to us.
Really.
a word from our sponsor.
This episode is brought to you by Mubi, a curated streaming service dedicated to elevating great cinema from around the globe.
From iconic directors to emerging auteurs, there's always something new to discover.
With Mubi, each and every film is hand-selected, so you can explore the best of cinema streaming anytime, anywhere.
And this week, we wanted to recommend a couple of newer releases in the library, both now streaming in the U.S. I wanted to tell you a little bit about Free Cholsu Lee, which came out last year and is a terrific documentary about an innocent man wrongly accused. Mike, you know how much I love my innocent man wrongly accused documentaries. And this is a really good one. The titular Cholsu Lee was a Korean immigrant who was wrongfully convicted of a 1973 murder in San Francisco. And his case became a big sort of rallying point for the Pan-Asian community. And then the movie goes on after he is released for about another half hour and complicates the traditional narrative in a really interesting way. This is a super compelling documentary, really, really worth your time. That one again is Free Cholsu Lee. Mike, what do you got?
I would recommend checking out The Actress, starring friend of the show Isabel Sandoval. It is a short film. It is just sort of really, really super creative and actually delves into the mind of an actress and sort of not just playing it out, but what it means as a human being to try to embody other people.
Nice.
So it's actually like it's a really cool movie, but it's also a study of movies and of people that we've had on this show. And Isabel is fantastic in it, and all the costumes are amazing, and it's just a super, super cool movie. And it's 8 minutes. Like, come on, you dig it.
Oh, hell,
dig it. Exactly.
Yeah, no excuse for not watching that.
Exactly.
You could try Mubi free for 30 days at Mubi.com/a very good year.
That's Mubi.com/a very good year, all one word, for a whole month of great cinema for free.
Yay, free! So let's then find out what films were winning trophies and making money in 1933. Here's Mike with awards and box office.
Sell out with me, oh yeah, sell out with me tonight.
This was the last year of that weird split year span, right, for Oscar eligibility.
Oh,
we've talked about this before.
Yeah.
It would like follow the school year, sort of. So as a result, the films in 33 that were up for Oscars were lumped in with films released after August 1st, 32. So there was actually a 17-month eligibility this year.
Well, they could get themselves on an actual calendar.
I'm sure there were people who complained about that.
I'm sure.
Best Director went to Frank Lloyd, and Best Picture went to Cavalcade.
I've not seen Cavalcade.
I sounded excited about that, but I've not either.
No, all right.
Best Actor went to Charles Laughton for The Private Life of Henry VIII. This was the first British film to win an American Academy Award.
That is a delightful movie, I will say, though. And Charles Laughton, of course, is a delightful actor. I have seen that one. Very good. Very great early Laughton.
Yeah, no, he's fun to watch.
Best Actress to Katharine Hepburn for Morning Glory.
Hey, I like Katharine Hepburn. She's got some skills.
I like her very much, and I like Morning Glory. It's a great Hepburn era.
Yeah.
Best short subject cartoon went to Walt Disney for The Three Little Pigs.
That wasn't one of the majors, but I just wanted to point out that The Three Little Pigs won an Oscar, and I love that. That's amazing. one of my youngest daughter's favorite Disney cartoons, and it's a great little cartoon. The songs are iconic, as the kids say these days.
Stands the test of time.
And it's like, it's about like pigs and wolves, so it's like not racist.
Well, I think there's some sort of argument that it was a parable for fascism. I think there's an argument about that. I guess they say that about all cartoons from this era.
Domestic box office top 10, number 10, Dinner at 8.
Oh, I love Dinner at 8.
That was one of my honorable mentions. Another great Jean Harlow performance.
Great in that.
Yes. But also, I mean, stacked cast. One of those great ensemble comedies, very sophisticated, which is wonderful.
Yeah.
Number 9, another movie you've mentioned while we've been here, 42nd Street.
The classic.
I love 42nd Street, yeah.
tough to beat. It was only Forgotten Man that put mine over the edge, but that one really stands. It's actually more dramatic than my pick, and has a great central performance. And then of course maybe the most quoted line from a musical of all time,
which is
you got to get back out there on the stage. He's gonna He's gonna make you a star, right? That's the famous line that I just boggled, because I think people always get the line slightly wrong, just like all the lines from Casablanca.
Exactly. Anyway, exactly. Yes. Yeah. No, I watched this one for the New York book, and I was really taken with it. But I was also struck by the thing you said earlier, which is like it's a backstage musical, so all the musical numbers grow organically from the plot, like their performances in the show. But then you watch them in the movie, and they're all shot from these crazy Busby Berkeley angles, and it's like this would actually be a terrible show to watch on the stage. You'd just be looking at like the backs of people's heads for an hour and a half.
Number 8, Dancing Lady with Joan Crawford and Clark Gable.
Oh yeah, that was one of my honorable mentions too. That's great and delightful musical, also famous because it's the first movie Fred Astaire is in. This is a big year for him. He's in this and another movie, and then we will start a whole new series of great musicals.
Yeah, there's a lot of musicals on this top 10 list. Like, that was the thing that was really strong. Almost half of this list is, like, musical comedies. Like, they were the superhero movies of their day, Megan.
Absolutely. Getting away from it all is really, yes, I think, and the buoyancy of them. And a lot of them came from very successful stage shows, too.
And tap dancing. A lot of tap dancing.
Always. Yeah. In Hell the old style. Yeah. Like Ruby Keeler, really hard. You know, this is not, Astaire is going to change a lot of that, but the really hard stomp of Ruby Keeler, which is like, she's going to murder someone on her
cheek. Number 7, Footlight Parade, Jimmy Cagney.
That was also on my honorables. That's really another great Busby Berkeley set of numbers in that one. Spectacular.
Jimmy Cagney doing some tap dancing as well in that one?
Indeed. Yeah. This is when he was really showing himself to be, you know, annihilating gangster.
Yeah. and a song and dance man.
Yes.
Number 6, the 1933 King Kong. Yes.
Oh, hell yes.
That was my big move, is to not include that, only because I thought, well, everyone's 1933 movie people will have seen if they've seen any 1933. I mean, it's a great movie, but I felt like I didn't have to stomp for that.
Number 5, Tugboat Annie with Marie Dressler and Wallace Beery.
I have seen that one. That is pretty funny.
It is fun.
I mean, I don't say it's a movie as a whole, but yeah, performance. I mean, she's one of the best. She's also in Dinner at 8 and really spectacular. This is Wallace Beery, who's years later, Barton Fink will have to write a wrestling picture for him.
There should be a 70s exploitation movie called Tugboat Annie that takes place on like a gambling, one of those like, you know, stationary gambling boats, you know?
Yeah.
Number 4, She Done Him Wrong, Mae West and a baby Cary Grant.
Yeah.
Yes. As beautiful as Gary Cooper. That was on my honorables too. I loved Mae West as a little girl as well. And that's another one with innuendo that would be impossible
to end. Like her last burst of freedom was sort of her first burst of stardom. It's a real fucking bummer is what it is.
Number 3. We spoke about this one already. The Gold Diggers of 1933. Fantastic movie. Yep. Number 2. Mae West, back again. I'm No Angel. Oh, baby Cary Grant's back again, too. Yeah. They were knocking it out that year.
Probably
behind the scenes, too.
No, this is, I love the fact that both of these early Mae West movies came out in the same calendar year. Like just roars out of the gate and then just gets like immediately decimated by Joseph Breen.
Like, hurry up while you get it while you can. It's almost like they're running for their lives.
Yes, exactly.
And number 1, another musical featuring Eddie Cantor, Roman Scandals. I tried, I couldn't.
I have seen this. It's also a visually stunning movie, and Eddie Cantor is great, and there's a orgy, nudity, and
I gotta finish it then.
I mean, some of these movies have problematic stuff in it. That movie has a lot of it, I'll just say that. You can like dot 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 it.
It was striking to me that, like, I mean, first of all, that, you know, first of all, that the number one movie of 1933 earned $2.4 million, like a tidy sum. But that the number one movie of 33 was like an Eddie Cantor vehicle. And I feel like he is one of these stars who was very big at the time, but who, you know, has sort of disappeared into the, you know, the dustbin of history. Like we don't talk about Eddie Cantor all that much these days.
He was a big force. Yeah. As you say.
I'm not sure what it was about his personality that sort of didn't stand the test of time the way that like Mae West does, or W.C. Fields, who we'll mention, or the Marx Brothers, or any of the other sort of contemporary comedians. But he had a moment in 1933. That's for damn sure.
Yeah. Yes. No, it is. It always is mysterious that way. I think, you know, with the decline of the musical, which would be quite a bit less popular this kind a few years later, Astaire Rogers, this is that more very different kind of musical. It feels like he, you know, these are more stage based. He came from theater and vaudeville, and it does feel like there's some kind of turn of the tide that didn't work in his favor. But he's also just really funny.
Yeah,
it's
he
just
is funny.
A shame.
Yeah. All right. Well, Megan, you want to do a lightning round?
Yes.
Okay, Mike, 5 minutes on the big clock for us. And here we go. Because you just mentioned it, the first Fred and Ginger movie, Flying Down to Rio, was released in 1933.
Great movie.
Yes, spectacular. They're not the main characters, and that would never happen again. They would never heard a movie. They steal the movie out from under Dolores del Rio. It was beautiful, but this is the first time they dance together, and it's spectacular, and it will yield several more gorgeous movies to come. So, yeah, thumbs up on that.
James Whale's The Invisible Man.
That was also in my honorable mentions. It's incredible, iconic. Whale, really one of the best of the Universal horror directors, and just a beautiful director in general. That is just recently on HBO Max streaming. People can get it if they've never seen it. It's quite a feat.
Great movie.
Claudette Colbert in The Torch Singer.
Yes, I love this movie. This is a melodrama, the unlikely story of she plays a woman who gives up child up for adoption, becomes a torch singer, and then she rises to the height of fame and glory and money, and tries to find her daughter. It's a real melodrama in the we later think of Douglas Sirk tradition. It's a real tearjerker and gorgeous to look at, and really over the top, and an enormous amount of plot packed in. A very short movie.
Greta Garbo as Queen Christina.
This really iconic movie, less watched today, but really I think the great Garbo performance, haunting. This is also has some fascinating erotic subtext in it, and gender fluidity as well. And it's just really, if you want to understand why people for fascinated by Garbo, this is the movie, I think, to see if you just see one. But you'll want to see more after this.
Yes.
she has something that's almost undefinable.
She sure does. William Wellman's Wild Boys of the Road.
Great little film.
Oh, yes. This is a great hobo tramps, kids on the ride in the rails movie. Wellman's sort of, well, I think they call him Wild Man Wellman. He's a sort of free and easy director, and really the real life. This feels like real life, even if it's slightly more exciting patter, but it's a great movie. Really just sheer delight, and really captures another aspect of that era, that the quote unquote hobo culture.
George Cukor's take on Little Women.
Really wonderful. Still my favorite of all the 150 adaptations. great Katharine Hepburn as Jo. She will always be my Jo. A real sob fest at the end. you know, he really is one of the great directors of the 30s. Also directed part of Gone with the Wind along with Victor Fleming. And was sort of famously known as a woman's director, which was code for a lot of things. But the movie's just great, I think.
Yeah. I feel like we'll know we've really been doing a lot of shows when we've hit all of the Little Women in the lightning round. The one and only Marx Brothers in Duck Soup.
Great movie.
Yes. This, I mean, definitely should have been on the list, but I also feel like people know this one, but maybe not. I never know how people know the Marx Brothers now, or if they pick the wrong one. If you're going to pick one, this would probably be the one I would recommend as a first one to really get their, sort of insane energy and operatics and, you know, 100 things going on screen at once and sort of whole wild energy of that. And this was, as a kid, I loved all these movies and have never stopped. Are you Marx Brothers fans?
Huge, yeah. Huge. They were my entry into classic cinema. Like, they were the first old movies I ever watched. Gene Harlow again, and again with Clark Gable in Hold Your Man.
Very underrated pre-code. I think it's starting to get a little resurgence in recent years, but it's a real tough as nails with re-teaming her with Clark Gable, and it's a real sort of kitchen sink. One of these 30s movies where they sort of flip around genres a lot. There's parts that are really funny, parts that are very dramatic, parts that are really seedy, and it's fantastic. And another, they had great chemistry, the two of them.
Yeah. Barbara Stanwyck was very busy, not only in Babyface, but also Ladies They Talk About and Ever in My Heart.
I've never seen Ever in My Heart, but why okay. not? I have to look that up. But Ladies They Talk About is all-time favorite. One of the great women's prison movies. it's got all the tropes to come in women's prison movies. And I do mean all of them are in this one. And it's fantastic. And it's really hard. Like those early 30s movies, they're so hard. It's just spectacular.
Great. And then let's wrap it up with the only actor who was busier in 1933 than Barbara Stanwyck. James Cagney was in not only the aforementioned Footlight Parade, but was in Hard to Handle, Picture Snatcher, The Mayor of Hell, and Lady Killer. Any of these ones that you've seen?
Picture Snatcher is actually a low-key favorite of mine because it's loosely inspired by the tabloid photographer Ouija, you know,
yeah.
who took those iconic
yeah.
photographs. It's about one of those photographers and is a real little hidden treasure, definitely worth seeing. I mean, I think he had a better, in general, 31, 32 than 33, but he comes back again next year. I mean, those other ones I've seen a couple of those. Actually, now that I say it, I did go on a long cast. Cagney run, but Footlight Parade, I think, is his real star this year. He's so great in that movie.
Beautiful. All right. Excellent lightning round. Megan Abbott, thank you so much for coming on. We're going to throw it to our friend WXL Foley for a quick PSA.
Head on over to your favorite podcasting app. Give us a star, a rate, a review. Give us a written review and tell us that you love us, because that's what lets people know that we're here.
And Megan, where can people follow you on social media if they're so inclined?
I'm on Instagram and Twitter for now. And I can be found pretty easily in both places. I enjoy my Twitter, but these are our dark days.
Yes, they are. Yes, they are indeed. And what's your handle on those platforms?
I think it's Megan E. Abbott on Twitter. I feel like on Instagram, I'm verified. I'm still unverified on there, but I'm easy to find. But I think it's actually Emmy Eliza Abbott because I was a later adopter. So, but you can find me by, I believe I have a baby face picture on as the most recent nice. Screenshot from baby face. So you will know
well
me about a baby face.
Well done. All right, I am Fun City Cinema on Instagram, Jason-Bailey on Letterboxd, where you can find under my lists the top five for every episode of this show. Mike, where can people find you?
I am at BrainwashedLib on Twitter.
And I should also mention that we are now on Substack, averygoodyear.substack.com. Right now, you'll find the podcast and show notes, but stay tuned for some extra goodies for paid subscribers. Mike, before we go, what is your favorite movie of 1933?
I used to be Land Without Bread, the Buñuel documentary that like is about this like little town in Spain that makes fucking Tennessee look like a parade of roses in 33. But I tried to watch that shit again and it is just unwatchably cruel, bro. Like it is. That can't be my favorite movie from this year anymore. It's good, yeah. but you don't need to watch it twice. Like that movie's fucking yeah. brutal. So my yeah. favorite year for movie from 1933 is Hallelujah, I'm a Bum. It is a fantastic, it's an Al Jolson. And like, you know, I watched some of like Jazz Singer and then I was like, like, all right, that's what that guy did. Fuck him. And I didn't really pay any attention to Al Jolson again for years after that. And I still don't remember why I ever watched this movie, but it's just delightful. It is like all the rich people are stupid. All the like smart, like good, genuinely lovely characters in the movie are all poor as hell. Like it is very directly about the Depression and about sort of surviving in that era. And Al Jolson's just great, dude. He's got a black best friend, you know, similar to Babyface, and they do everything together. And like, you can't disrespect his fucking friend, you know, like is not a sort of servant character. He's frequently pouring like coffee that's clear because they don't have any coffee. So it's just hot water. It's such a great movie, dude. It's such a great movie. And there's all these great songs about how like you can be poor, but you don't have to like be fucking miserable about it, bro. Like that's sort of to me the message that I get from a lot of the songs in the movie. It's really great. And then there's a lady and she has amnesia. And if you've ever seen a fucking movie before, you know what's going to end up happening with her, you know, once sort of she falls in love with Al Jolson. Right. But anyway, Hallelujah, I'm a Bum. The song itself is great, but the movie is lovely.
Yeah, it was on the lightning round list. We didn't get to it just because it's my favorite title of a movie for 1933.
And I should add that Al Jolson was married to Ruby Keeler from Gold Diggers in 1933. So it's what a power couple.
Nice pull, Al Jolson.
I would ask you what your favorite movie of 1933 is, but I'm pretty sure you have a duck soup tattoo. So I'm just going to go on ahead and say it's Duck Soup.
Oh, no, I should have picked it.
You know, when you were like, should I do this year or this year? I said 33 in the hopes that you would pick Duck Soup, but it's cool. You're right. The logic is sound. People who know this era have seen Duck Soup. But yes, the Marx Brothers are like, they're my everything. I discovered them as like a 9-year-old. I was real popular. And they were very much my entry point into old movies and then just sort of into cinephilia in general. And there are things to like in all of their movies, but that 3-picture run of Monkey Business, Horse Feathers, and Duck Soup is like their absolute best. Like pure uncut anarchy, chaos, brilliance. Those movies make me laugh. I've seen them all like probably over 100 times each, and they still make me laugh every damn time. I love Duck Soup so much, but Babyface is a really close second. Really close. So thank you again, Megan Abbott.
Oh, thank you guys. This was so much fun.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you, Jason.
And thank you for listening.
It was a very good year.